All right. Yeah, so they told me that I was going to have to stand in a red circle, and they told me all the things they tell TED speakers, but they didn't tell me about this. too bad, I guess. I'm just going to have to hope for the best. All right, so this is the foundation that I work for, that I'm the chief science officer of, and this is what we do. I can reassure you that the technologies that we work on do not include standing in a box of ice. We are interested in what I'm going to be calling rejuvenation biotechnologies to combat aging. We are interested in trying to do something about the problem of aging. And I'm going to start just by telling you what that means in slightly more accurate terms than a lot of people think about it. So I'm going to start this slide from the bottom. Do I have a laser pointer on this? No. So most people think of aging as the right thing to die of. They think that when you die of old age, you die of natural causes. In other words, you basically avoid all of the really horrible things that we all agree we don't want to get, like Alzheimer's disease and cardiovascular disease and cancer and so on. And you have a good innings, and eventually you pass away relatively peacefully in a condition that is relatively healthy for your age. So first of all, I don't like the term healthy for your age. As far as I'm concerned, it's just a contradiction in terms. You're healthy or you're not healthy. And if you think that there's such a thing as being healthy for your age, then it's just ageism, really. It's just saying that old people are entitled. It's okay for old people to be sick. And I think that's stupid. But anyway, so the big thing I want to say here. Okay, if you want. All right, let me see if it works, first of all. Yeah, it works. The big thing I want to point out is that actually this supposed distinction between aging on the one hand and the diseases of old age on the other hand is a false distinction. It's a distinction that some people like to suggest just in order to in some way make their own work look more important or something, but the fact is it's not true. The only reason why the diseases of old age are diseases of old age is because they are the later stages of some process that goes on throughout life. Otherwise, they would happen to young adults as well. So that's really the way that we should think about the diseases of old age. If we really want to do anything about the diseases of old age, the disabilities of old age, we've really got to do something about aging itself. It's pretty easy to see that this would be a good idea. If I go back for a second and talk about these numbers, out of the 150,000 people that die every day worldwide, 2/3 of them die of aging, if we remember that aging includes all of the age-related diseases. In the industrialized world, it's 90% of all deaths. That's fairly obviously the world's biggest problem, and certainly the world's biggest medical problem. And even if you were lucky enough to avoid all the diseases of old age and get to a state where you're in danger of dying of natural causes, what part of this slide do people not understand? It's fairly obviously preferable to be in the state on the bottom photograph rather than the state in the top photograph, even if the guy who's just jumping off the boat is about to have his head bitten off by a shark. It doesn't really matter. So this is what we're interested in doing. We're interested in maintaining people's health properly so that people are not just healthy for their age, they're actually properly healthy. And they're in not only the same condition to look at them, they don't just look like young adults, they actually feel like young adults and they function like young adults however long they live. That is the goal of my work and the work of the people I work with. So, of course, this entails the cure of specific diseases and the prevention of specific diseases. It does have a side effect, which is that people may live a great deal longer, but I want to emphasize that that is a side effect. It is not the primary purpose of this work. The primary purpose is absolutely to keep people healthy. And, of course, the social and economic benefits of not having so many people getting sick and decrepit and dependent and debilitated are rather obvious as well. So it's fairly easy to say that this seems like a good idea. But some of you may be aware that there is a certain degree of ambivalence in society about this question. And certainly when I find myself talking to non-scientists especially about the problems that we want to solve by then they tend not to be terribly interested in those problems. They tend to be interested in the possible problems that might be created by the defeat of aging. You know, people say, well, won't dictators live forever? Or, you know, how will we pay the pensions? Or won't it be boring and so on? And, you know, yeah, wouldn't it be really boring not getting Alzheimer's disease? You know, I mean... So it strikes me as somewhat incongruous that people should be able to put this rather bad problem that we have today out of their minds and just not talk about it and not think about it in the same way that they would be rational in every other walk of life. And I actually, you know, used to be very unsympathetic about this, but I gradually began to realize that it makes perfect sense for people to think that way while it is genuinely impossible for the foreseeable future to do anything about aging. Because clearly, if there's this terrible, ghastly thing that's going to happen to you in the relatively distant future, and you can't do anything whatsoever about it, then it makes sense to try to put it out of your mind rather than to spend your miserably short life being preoccupied by it. And if that's what you're going to do, then it doesn't really matter how you put it out of your mind. It doesn't matter how irrational your rationalizations actually are. What matters is that they work, that you succeed in tricking yourself into the view that aging is actually a rather good thing after all, and that we'd probably not better do anything about it. So I'm reasonably sympathetic to that point of view. Except, of course, for the minor fact that I think that we are no longer in the situation of having no chance for the foreseeable future of doing anything about aging. I think that we're getting close. And I'm going to tell you why I think that over the next few minutes. But, of course, that does rather undermine the logic of this, what I'm calling, rational denial. And it's somewhat frustrating to me that it's taking rather a long time for people to, you know, wake up and realize that their previously rational approach to this problem has now become an enormous part of that problem. Okay, so I'm going to start talking about some biology now. Now, a long time ago, a very famous guy named Peter Medawar described aging as an unsolved problem in biology. And many people since then have called it the major unsolved problem in biology. But it isn't. It's a completely solved problem, more or less. We know pretty much exactly what aging is in mammals, certainly, we have a pretty good idea how to describe it, as I shall be doing shortly. And if we want to describe it in very simple terms, then it comes down to what I'm saying here. I've said some of this already, that aging is the lifelong process that gives rise to debilitation in old age. So, putting that in other words, there is a set of what we might call damage, types of molecular and cellular change in the body that accumulate throughout life as intrinsic, unavoidable side effects of normal, essential metabolic processes like breathing, and which eventually, when they get abundant enough, cause, as I say, the debilitation and dysfunction of old age. So that's a nice, straightforward definition of aging, and it's completely uncontroversial. Pretty much everyone who studies the biology of aging would agree with that definition. But what we can say about aging is that, no, it's not the major unsolved problem in biology, but it sure as hell is the major unsolved problem in medicine. Because the approaches that we have today for doing anything about aging are not working. The main approach that we have today, the approach that people, that medical doctors are taking, is what I'm going to call the geriatrics approach. And the geriatrics approach basically says, let's focus on old people. Let's focus on people in whom the pathologies of old age are already emerging. Let's try and in some way slow down the rate at which those pathologies progress and are exacerbated so that we postpone the age at which the pathologies become life-threatening. And that's a good idea in principle, clearly. Another approach, which tends to be followed by people who study the basic biology of aging, is to say, well, okay, in principle, prevention is better than cure. So surely we might actually do more if we try to somehow clean up metabolism, if we try to slow down the rate at which our normal metabolic processes create these various types of molecular and cellular damage in the first place. And that's a fine idea as well. So what's the situation? Why are we doing so badly in actually getting these ideas to work, in actually significantly, substantially postponing and controlling the diseases and disabilities of old age in the same way that we can so well control most infectious diseases, for example? Basically, the answer to why the geriatrics approach doesn't work is this. Aging is very messy and chaotic and complicated and horrible. Lots and lots of different things go wrong all at the same time. They interact, they exacerbate each other. It really is a case of prevention being better than cure. We just are not in a position to do anything about this when it gets this late. Really what it comes down to is that these problems are getting worse and getting harder and harder to treat all the time simply because they are the consequences of something that's getting worse all the time, something that's accumulating all the time, namely damage. So that leaves us with the gerontology approach. But unfortunately, that's got this problem, which is that metabolism is very, very, very complicated. Actually, this is not really the problem. This here is a small subset of what we know about how metabolism works. A simplified diagram, actually, of a small subset of what we know. But that's not the problem. The real problem is that this is a simplified diagram of a small subset of what we know about how metabolism works, which is completely dwarfed, as any biologist will tell you, by the absolutely astronomical amount that we don't know about how metabolism works, even completely ignoring all the stuff that we don't even know that we don't know. So the gerontology approach certainly, in principle, could work a lot better than the geriatrics approach ever could. But it is an idea whose time has very, very, very much not come. We have to know just incalculably more than we currently do about how biology really functions in order to have the faintest chance of cleaning up, of intervening in this process in a manner that doesn't do more harm than good. So, well, that all sounds a bit miserable, doesn't it? It sounds as though maybe we are still in a situation where it makes sense to engage in this rational denial that I talked about earlier. But no, there's a third approach, and that's the approach that Sense Foundation and an increasing number of other people are paying a lot of attention to now. I like to call it rejuvenation biotechnologies. If you like, you could call it the repair and maintenance approach to the problem of aging, which says, basically, rather than trying to slow down the rate at which metabolism creates damage, or slow down the rate at which damage translates into pathology, let's instead just uncouple those two processes from each other by going in and periodically repairing the damage, not necessarily perfectly, just reasonably well, so that we will postpone the age at which the damage reaches the pathogenic level. And there's no reason why we shouldn't be able to do that indefinitely, just as we do already with simple man-made machines like, you know, cars or airplanes or whatever. The reason we have 100-year-old cars is because we can, because comprehensive enough periodic maintenance really works. And let's face it, the human body is just a machine. It's a really complicated machine, but it's just a machine. So in principle, the same approach ought to work. All right, that's in principle. What about practice? How close are we? Well, I've only got 5 minutes and 26 seconds left, so I'm not going to tell you. But I will tell you in very brief summary that the problem of aging, the damage of aging that I've been talking about, can, in my view and in the view of a lot of people now, be broken down and classified really rather nicely into the seven major themes that I'm listing on the left-hand side of this table here. Things like, you know, cell loss, which is simply the progressive death of cells in organs that are not good at replacing those cells automatically by the division and differentiation of other cells. So Parkinson's disease is a fine example of that. There's a particular part of the brain in which neurons die unusually rapidly and are not replaced, and in people in whom they die particularly rapidly, the consequence is the loss of ability to create a chemical called dopamine, and that's what leads to Parkinson's disease. So that's just one example of an aspect of aging that's caused by one type of damage that accumulates throughout life. And I could carry on down this list and talk about all the others, but as I say, I've only got 4 minutes and 15 seconds. The question then is, of course, can we fix these things? And that, of course, is what the list on the right-hand side is. If I didn't have a list on the right-hand side, then again, I wouldn't be able to come up and tell you that I think the maintenance approach is as powerful, as promising as I think it is. But the fact is, we can say what's going on here. There's just a one-word name or a three-word name for each of the approaches that I think are promising for addressing each of these problems on this table. But in the book I read a few years ago, there's an entire chapter on each of these things. And that's a really important point that I want to drive home. In any technology, in any new pioneering future technology, the way in which you can describe the problem, the details of how you can describe it, in particular the amount of detail, is a really good measure of how confident you can be in your estimate of how long it's going to take to actually implement the technology. And in this case, we can say a very great deal about what's already been done, what technologies have already been developed, and where we need to go, what we need to augment them with in order to actually deliver the therapies that I'm describing here. So that's why I've been saying for a little while that we may be only about 25 years, I would say we have a 50-50 chance of being only about 25 years away from the target that I have in the title of this slide, giving 30 years of additional life to people who are already in middle age before we start. As I mentioned earlier, there's no reason why we shouldn't get better and better at doing that, using the time that we are buying each time we rejuvenate people to improve the therapy so that we can give people, we can re-rejuvenate people and give them another 30 years and so on. Now, what that does actually lead to, as a number of people have noticed, is a rather extreme prediction for the consequences on longevity. That we may actually get indefinite lifespans really rather soon after we get lifespans increased by only, let's say, 30 years. And a lot of people are terribly scared about this because they think it's going to cause overpopulation or how we pay the pensions or, as I mentioned earlier, you know, won't dictators live forever and so on. But to be perfectly honest, I think it's rather important to emphasize that we need to think maturely about these problems and not just be satisfied with the knee-jerk reactions that so many people are prone to. It's very, very important to recognize, first of all, that this is going to happen slowly. We aren't going to have any 1,000-year-old people for 900 years, whatever happens, okay? So we've got to remember that during that time, there's going to be quite a lot of other technological advance, technological progress, that is going to shape the context in which this demographic change is going to occur. And therefore, it's actually quite sensible to carry on and think again about the problem that we want to solve, which is a very immediate, clear, and present problem, namely 100,000 people a day dying an unnecessarily early and unnecessarily painful death. Or rather, at least it will be unnecessary if we don't get on and try as hard as we can to fix this problem. You know, we would actually be quite happy if nobody got Alzheimer's disease and nobody got cancer and so on, and that's what we're talking about here. Oh, I've been told to skip over this slide. So I just want to emphasize here that it is fairly appalling that so little is being done to combat aging, to actually develop therapies that we might call preventative geriatrics. The rejuvenation biotechnologies that I've summarized today are basically simply the application of regenerative medicine to the problem of aging. Regenerative medicine is a fashionable concept. It's a fashionable area of research. But it's not being developed by gerontologists. It's being developed by people who tend to think that the main focus of their work is acute injury, you know, spinal cord damage, things like that. But the fact is it can be used against the gradual accumulating chronic damage of aging too. That's what we do, that's what I want to achieve. We have to understand that the reason why people are so apathetic, people are so ambivalent about this is basically because they still don't quite believe it can be done, that they've convinced themselves that aging is a good thing anyway. Maybe they think that the people who are working on aging are not really, on this problem, are not really equipped to actually deliver these technologies, even if the concept of using regenerative medicine against aging is valid. But ultimately, I think it all comes down to peer pressure. It all comes down to not wanting to be laughed at by your friends because they haven't heard this talk. So make sure they hear this talk. I'll stop there.